What's up, guys? It is Wednesday, November 16th. It is 10:27 a.m., and this is the deep dive of the day, and it's going to be on XRP, a global public good. I remember back, I think it was either like 2017, 2018, watching the Digital Asset Investor, and there was one video that, you know, when you watch a video and just like, it's like you can think back to it years later and be like, that's what sold me. This is one of those things that sold me, where I was like, huh, I never knew about this before, but he brought it to the attention back like 4 or 5 years ago. I'm not going to go fishing for that video, but yeah, man, like I've seen a lot, been in this space for a while. As soon as I joined, I was gravitated towards Ripple and Stellar from the jump. And, you know, I was watching all these guys, Digital Asset Investor, Darren Moore, King Solomon, Brad Kimes. I was watching them daily, every day, no days off on that. So I observed what everybody was finding and then able to take everybody's kind of perspectives and glue them all together and find the pieces and make them connect in a way that makes sense to somebody new coming into the space and want to learn more about XRP. I don't think people have mentioned the global public good thing lately or recently, but it's something that needs to be revisited because it is huge, absolutely huge. And we're going to dive into it. So let's go into the IMF. What are global public goods? December 2021. So it's almost been a year since this came out. And we see global institutions must coordinate to preserve the goods that benefits us all. The COVID-19 pandemic, refugee crisis, climate change, these global problems have exposed the need for public goods that are likewise global. What are public goods? How can they be supplied globally? Public goods are those that are available to all, non-excludable, and that can be enjoyed over and over again by anyone without diminishing the benefits they deliver to others. The scope of public goods can be local, national, or global. Public fireworks are a local public good, as anyone within an eye shot can enjoy the show. National defense is a national public good, as it benefits are enjoyed by citizens of the state. Global public goods are those whose benefits affect all citizens of the world. They encompass many aspects of our lives, from our natural environment, our histories and cultures, and technological progress down to everyday devices such as the metric system. No one can be prevented from using the metric system, and whenever someone uses it, its usefulness to others is not diminished. The nature of their benefits set public goods apart from private goods we see in stores or in the club goods we can pay a fee to access, but this also means they cannot be found in a store nor accessed via a simple fee. Creating public goods is much more difficult than supplying private goods, and providing global public goods poses a unique challenge. So why are public goods undersupplied? So supply and demand. It is not inevitable, however, that the world will continue to fail to provide global public goods. Many institutions that provide public goods today did not appear on their own, but formed in response to demand. Public education in the U.S. developed in response to citizen demands in a technologically advancing world. The IMF was established after the Great Depression and World War II as countries recognized the need to promote global financial stability. There is reason to believe that the demand for global public goods is growing, whether it is trade, capital flows, or migration. The world is far more interconnected now than it was back in 1945, when many global institutions such as the UN, IMF, World Bank, and World Health Organization were founded. The importance of global public goods in our everyday lives become more salient with each new crisis. C-19 has increased demand for global public health, refugee crisis for global peace, climate change for sustaining the global environment. These crises require a global framework that recognizes a shared obligation, clearly delineates each country's responsibility, and enforces these commitments. For global institutions to foster coordination, they need comprehensive governance structures to ensure that decisions are legitimate and represent all present and future citizens of the world. If the momentum that is building today can be harnessed and mobilized to build this global framework, the provision of global public goods may become a reality. Okay, so that's what it's all about. And then if we go into here, what is a global public good? We have some examples. So here are some examples. In the context of globalization, problems and remedies transcend national borders. Global public goods have become an increasingly important concept to international policy. A prominent example of a global public goods is global warming and carbon emissions. These are two concepts that no one nation can address on its own. Health is another international factor. And it talks about that. Yep. Okay. So even like this whole, they're trying to like implement the climate via global public goods. Carbon emissions, no one nation can address it on its own. There needs to be a global governance or framework to address this, right? Implication, there are calls to reassess the way in which public goods are designed, created, and managed in the era of globalization. Goods which are public by default are best classified as common goods until there are proper structures to categorize them as private or public. Global trade further requires the availability of such global public goods, such as stable monetary systems, widespread peace and global economic stability. There we go. So we know a global public good could be a new stable monetary system that's international. It's no borders, universal. It's a shared platform everyone can use, right? For the benefit of the whole world. So let's go into the Web3 Foundation, because the Web3 Foundation, they fund research and development teams who are building the foundation of the decentralized web. And what they have are projects here. So let's go into that. Actually, you know what? Just to skip a step, let's do Web3 Foundation Global Public Good.
So at this point,
So there, we got this video, Web3 Grants and the Future of Public Goods Funding. David Hawig is head of grants at the Web3 Foundation. This is David's talk, Web3's Grants and the Future of Public Goods Funding, at a summit they did in December of last year. So let's go into it. Let's try to find some gold nuggets.
We focus on funding open source software development and on the other hand, it's also really beneficial because for them, so let's start and see if it works or if applications that reach these or grants. So an example is usually Team X is working, but and the program you also for it because if you're running a.
So their goal is to centralize the funding of public goods. So Web3 Foundation is. Their goal is to decentralize the funding of public goods. So these protocols that are being built, these blockchain or distributed ledger protocols being built, are going to be global public goods because crypto block has no borders. So it's global. And these protocols are going to build immense value that are going to benefit the world. And, you know, one private, it's like if we go back to here, the availability of a stable monetary system or a new next-gen monetary system, it's just a global public good. It's a fact. It's right here. So that's where we're heading. And Web3 Foundation, they launched in, I can't find it, but there's one other thing. So TCIP Public Good Internet Protocols. All right. Okay. So now I actually found what he shared in the video. It was the World Wide Web Foundation or something like that, where World Wide Web Consortium. The World Wide Web Consortium is the main international standards organization for the World Wide Web. Founded in 1994, the consortium is made up of member organizations that maintain a full-time staff working together in the development of standards for the World Wide Web. All right, so now we can find here public. So now we can go back to their website here. And maybe we can search global or public goods. I'm trying to find the video from the Digital Asset Investor, but when I tell you it's literally from like 5 years ago, it really is. So it's going to be like impossible to find this, but it was huge because they've likely changed their website since then. So that's a fact. Because before, I remember he showed about the World Wide Web Consortium and how the TCIP or TCP, like the internet protocols, were gifted to the World Wide Web Consortium. And you have all these different kind of key stakeholders that are contributing to these protocols. And basically what we're seeing now is that the next kind of step of that, which is the same new distributed ledger protocols being now the next gen of public goods. So the connections are there because we're going from the internet of information to the internet of value. And you can see that right here. Nothing wants to pull up today. So this slide isn't pulling up, but this is back in September 2017, this document, and it talks about going from the internet of information to the internet of value. It talks about the protocols back in the internet and now the new protocols for the internet of value, which is Interledger. So now let's dive into Interledger because Interledger Foundation launches to build more equitable and creative opportunities on the web. Interledger and its global development community will advance an open payments network allowing for broader participation and economic opportunities on the web. They announced its formal launch to operations as a charitable nonprofit organization. The foundation's mission is to steward and advocate for Interledger, an open protocol that permits frictionless payments and micropayments across currencies and ledgers, resulting in opportunities for broader global financial inclusion. Although the creators of the internet knew that it was important to incorporate digital payments natively into its infrastructure, a web-native payments feature is still reserved for future use, according to its 402 error code. As a result, the gap has been filled over the last 30 years with closed fee-based and siloed payment networks, which have helped accelerate the financial exclusion of the world's 1.7 billion unbanked people. So through funding from its founding members, COIL, micropayments, and Ripple and its board of directors, the foundation will advance and support the Interledger protocol and its open source community in developing better technological standards and new business models for the unbanked and creative economy. The foundation is now the permanent home of the Grant for the Web program, which funds individuals, projects, and global communities contributing to an open and accessible web monetization ecosystem. The Interledger Foundation aims to bring global awareness to this amazing technology, and the potential impact would be life-changing for 1/3 of the world's population. I mean, that sounds like a global public good to me. By fostering the interoperability of formerly siloed networks and providing alternatives to traditional earning models on the web, the Interledger Protocol has the power to greatly advance financial inclusion and uplift the lives of billions in the process. Here we go. All right. Now here we're talking. Here's the connections. Because aided by the Interledger Foundation's Grant for the Web program, Innovations in Web Monetization, a proposed worldwide web consortium standard, are opening up an entire financial ecosystem for everyone from app and game developers, artists, musicians, podcasters, to journalists and freelancers. Using the Interledger protocol, the Web Monetization Browser API provides an open, native, efficient, and automatic way to compensate creators that does not force them to rely on advertising, site-by-site subscriptions, or tracking models. Interledger has the power to disrupt and equalize current online payment structures to expand financial access and help monetize the work of millions of creators on the web. Interledger is a more open global digital, enables a more open global digital economy. To truly enable open payments and web monetization requires interoperability between data, money, and beyond. Open source protocols like Interledger have the potential to change this, doing for money what the internet did for data, internet of information, and the internet of value, and making it possible for 1.7 billion unbanked people to more fully participate in the formal global financial system. Partnering with the foundation brings us one step closer to achieving this vision by creating standards for payments that will in turn foster opportunities for the budding creator economy to monetize. So then it talks about Interledger, talks about the grant that they got from the World Wide Web Consortium. So those connections are there and you're seeing the same type of verbiage and or comparisons back to the internet of information, the internet of value. So now let's go to their website, Grant for the Web. The Interledger Foundation is now the official home of the Grant for the Web. Same kind of announcement there. I think this is actually the same kind of article. So now let's keep going forward because Interledger Protocol preface. The Interledger Protocol is the culmination of more than a decade of research in decentralized payment protocols. This work was started in 2004 by Ryan Fugger, augmented by the development of Bitcoin in 2008, and has involved numerous contributors since then. And the Interledger Foundation aims to make web payments as easy as email. The Interledger Foundation aims to create a web-based payments infrastructure that will allow greater global financial inclusion. And then you have right here, to achieve its mission of a global financial inclusion, the Interledger Foundation operates as a 501c charitable organization to maintain and advance Interledger as a public good in service of financial inclusion. Any bank, provider, government office, or other entity can freely use Interledger. All right, now I finally found this document because it, from the Internet of Information, right? The emergence of the Internet of Information in the 90s was possible thanks to the creation of the Internet protocols, TCP, IP, HTTP. Internet protocols enabled open innovation to flourish. Companies like Amazon, eBay, Rakuten, Google, Alibaba were born once Internet protocols gained adoption. Today's information moves seamlessly over the internet, and due to its open and neutral nature, the internet has given rise to all types of products and services that were previously unimaginable. Now we're at the internet of value. So the internet of value. The internet of value will make for money and other forms of value what the internet did for information. To the internet of information, that Internet of Value needs open protocols and standards to enable the many value networks in the world to connect with one another and become interoperable. As banks and other financial institutions adopt open standards like Interledger Protocol to connect between each other and with blockchain networks, we'll see the Internet of Value emerge. Interledger is going to be the backbone of the Internet of Value. Blockchain technology and smart contracts will enable programmable money and frictionless transfer of digital assets, lowering the cost to transact and giving rise to seamless transactions between people, institutions, and Internet of Things. And the technology breakthrough, the experimental platforms, Bitcoin and Ethereum, but the maturity and adoption of enterprise level platforms for specific use cases, you got Ripple there, you got Chain there, you can get the Chain on Coinbase, digital asset, R3 Quarter, Hyperledger Fabric. Then it talks about the similarities between the Interledger protocol and the Internet of Information, the application layer, the transport layer, the core layer, the network layer, right? And then we see, as we move through here, we see banks' adoption of real-time settlement distributed ledger technology. And then as we keep going a little bit more, Interledger, enabling interoperability across all platforms. All platforms. And we have Japan, Europe, United States, UK, China. We have like the payment systems are there. Then we have Interledger Protocol connecting with the XRP Ledger, connecting to Interledger Protocol, connecting to like commercial banks, connecting to Interledger Protocol, connecting to all these different kind of segments, which have all these companies and platforms. All the money, Interledger is going to be the standard and the backbone to connect all of these systems. And without it, you're not going to see companies arise like Amazon, the Googles, the Facebooks without Interledger. So Interledger is a global public good. It seems like that's what they're getting ready to implement here. And it's going to take a international conference and one announcement. And there's many coming up. There's many happening as we speak. So be prepared. The grand finale, we're very close. And I will see you guys in the Discord. If you're not already in it, link in the bio, join the Discord. Say what up. I'll say what up back. And yeah, so that's it for this video, guys. I'll see you in there.